What is heaven like? With what shall we compare the kingdom of God? Last week, as many of you know, I spent 3 days at the London Conference Annual General Meeting. And I can tell you now that I sure hope that ain't heaven. If I ever hear anybody say, the kingdom of heaven is like a committee meeting, I'm out of there. It's just not a place I really want to go. Now Jesus, especially in Matthew's gospel, more so than in the other three, Mark, Luke, or John, Jesus talks often about the kingdom of heaven. And he starts off with that phrase, with what shall we, what is the kingdom like? With what shall we compare it? Some of the images that Jesus uses to describe the kingdom are easy images, fairly simple to see, and also, in a sense, fairly comforting in their familiarity. For example, Jesus described the kingdom of heaven as a hidden treasure. He described it as that which is found by a one person in a field. There we go. Whoa. We got graphics for you today, so. But we're working out some kinks, so bear with us on this. But so the kingdom of heaven is like a hidden treasure that a man finds in a field, and he goes home and he sells everything that he has to go and buy that field so that the treasure may be his. Jesus also said that the kingdom of heaven is like, as we heard this morning, a small seed, a tiny seed that drops to the ground, but will grow to a mighty tree in which eagles may nest. Now these are the beautiful images. They're easy images to grasp hold of, and in that they're comfortable. You know, hidden treasure. Well, who doesn't like the idea of finding a hidden treasure? All right, then let me ask you, who doesn't like the idea of winning the lottery? Because isn't that a hidden treasure? And one person, well, you know, maybe more than one person, you know, isn't that a disappointment to have to split a huge jackpot amongst other people because, you know, it's never enough. So, it's a comfortable image to grab hold of. And the seed, we see seeds like this. We know that they're tiny and we're amazed at what we see happen from them. Some of the images, though, are even somewhat baffling. The kingdom of heaven, Jesus said, is like a wedding feast that a king was holding. And the king sent out invitations throughout the land to all the nobles. And when the day of the feast came, nobody showed up. And so the king sent his servants out to go to those who had been invited to say, why are you not at the feast? And the servants came back and said, we asked for a question, O master, and they told us that we were busy, and we will come later. And the king said, oh, those wretched guests, go out into the street and bring in anybody who is out there, and have them sit at my great feast. Who here understands that as an analogy for the kingdom? Doesn't it seem strange? Like, wouldn't you think anybody invited into the kingdom of heaven would want to be there? Wouldn't you think anybody invited to that great feast would want their place at the table? It's a baffling image. But Jesus is telling us that the kingdom of heaven is not as clear as we may like to guess it is. It is not a clear matter of who is in and who is out. And in fact, in its bafflingness, let me try to make this simple. Many people who think they're in because they have the invitation, according to Jesus, are not. They won't be at the table. But those who will be at the table are those you don't expect. There'll be people who are completely different from us. The ones we would think stood on the outside and didn't belong at the king's banquet. They're the ones who will be there celebrating. While others who hold the invitation in their hand are wasting their time when they could be with the master celebrating. Not as comfortable as the hidden treasure, is it? Some of the imagery should outright unsettle us because they demand that we look at the way we live here and now. Jesus said, "With what shall we compare the kingdom of heaven?" It is like a wealthy man who was going on a way, and he left his talents with his servants. To one, he left five, to the other, he left two, and to the third, he left one, each according to their ability. And when the king returned, he called his servants to settle the debt. And the first servant, who was given five talents, five gold coins, said, "Master, I took the five that you gave me, and I raised five more with it. Here is your 10 talents. And likewise, the one who was given two brought the two and said to his master, "I took those two that you gave me, and I have made two more with it. Here, master, are your 4 talents. And the master says, "Well done, good and faithful servants. Now come and share in your master's wealth." But the third, who had been given 1 gold coin, came and said, "Master, I know you are a tough and hard man. I know that you reap where you do not sow. And I was afraid. So I took the talent that you gave me, this 1 gold coin, and I buried it in the ground, so that nobody would know where it was and nobody would find it. And I would be able to be a good servant also and bring you back your 1 talent. He's got a big smile on his face as he presents the talent that he so carefully saved for his master. And his master thunders at him, "You wretched, wretched servant, get out of my sight. If you knew that I reap where I do not sow, if you knew that I was a hard man, why didn't you at least put that coin in the bank so I could have had a little bit of interest? You wasted what I gave you. Now get out of my sight and go where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." If this image for the kingdom doesn't unsettle us, then we need to look at this image again. Because it is clear what Jesus is saying. We're each given gifts. How will we use them? For those who will not use their gifts, but instead will covet them and hold them tight and make sure that they are in no way tarnished or abused. Those who would think they're doing the right thing are not. Jesus said, "With what shall we compare the kingdom of heaven? It is like 10 virgins who are waiting for the bridegroom to come. And they stayed up too late. And finally, they got drowsy and they went to sleep. But in the early, early hours of the morning, a voice cried out, 'The bridegroom comes! The time of the celebration is at hand.' Well, the virgins got up, and 5 of them had brought extra oil, and they lit their lamps to light the bridegroom's way. But the other 5, the foolish ones, were not prepared. And they said to the 5 who had oil, 'Can we have some of yours?' And the 5 whose lamps were lit said, 'No, it's too late. You need to go into the city and buy your own oil.' And so they ran as fast as they could to get to the city, to get oil, to get back for the bridegroom. But when they came back, they were too late. And the doors were bolted shut. And they pounded on the door and they cried out, "Please let us in, we are here." And the door master said, "I'm sorry, the bridegroom has come, the celebration has begun, and there is no more room for you." If we like an image of the kingdom that is peaceful and comfortable, little chairs floating on wings with the harps above the clouds, these images have to shake us. Because they say that what we hope may not be. The kingdom of heaven is not necessarily our hope fulfilled. It is God's hope fulfilled. And our call is to be like the five virgins who had oil, to be ready. We don't know when the bridegroom is going to come. We don't know when it will be time to settle accounts. But we have to be ready. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like a man who went out to hire workers for his field at the first watch in the morning. And he said to them, "I will pay you $30 for the day." And the servants went to work. 3 hours later, he went back and he found some people who were idle. And he said, "I need workers for my field. I will pay you $30 to go work in my field." And at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, he went back and he found more people idle on the streets. And he said, "I need people to work my field. Go and I will pay you $30 for the day." And then he came back at 5 o'clock and he found some people there. And he said, "I still need workers. Why are you not working?" And they said, "There's no one to hire us." He said, "Well, I will hire you. Now go into my field and work for, guess how much? $30. And so, when the time came, an hour later, for the workers to be paid, the workers who had come an hour earlier at 5 o'clock came and each received $30 from the master. And then the ones who came at 3 came, and they received $30. We worked 2 hours more than they did. Oh well, it's $30. And then the ones who started at 12 came, and they were paid. We worked 6 hours more than that first group, and 3 hours more than the second group, and oh well, it's $30. And then the first group came, thinking that they, since they had worked the whole day, they deserved a whole lot more because of how long they had worked in the hot sun. They deserved so much more. And the master paid them $30. And they complained. They said, "We deserve more." The master said, "Really? Did we not agree to $30? Why do you think you deserve more?" "Well, because you gave the ones who only worked an hour $30. We worked more than they did." But the master said, "Is it not mine to do with what I want?" This is an image of the kingdom of heaven. The master saying to the workers, "Is it not mine to do with what I want to do?" Unsettling. It should shake us at our knees and make us wonder, oh boy. We're going to skip this next one here, Bart. Most of us have an image of the kingdom of heaven. And it kind of may look like something like this. I know it does for me. You notice everybody's on their technology and everybody's happy. And they've got cups of coffee in their hand. Well, it's not London Conference AGM that I think will be heaven. This is my idea of heaven. Hallelujah. As much coffee as I want to drink and I'll still be able to sleep at night. So that's my hope for heaven. And yes, I've reached that point where if I have coffee after 5 p.m., I can't sleep at night. And I don't like this. So I want heaven to be continual flowing coffee and good night's sleeps. Or for others, it may look like this. Oh, good. I'm glad the reference was coffee. But it doesn't matter what we think might come after this. It doesn't matter if we think that heaven is West Virginia, or if we think it's endless cups of coffee, or if we think it's cherubs dancing upon the clouds with harps. It doesn't matter what might come after. And I believe in a sense that it doesn't matter, because what will come after is already in the mind of God. It's not ours. In fact, so many of the parables, especially the parables of the seed, the farmer doesn't know, the worker doesn't know what's happening. He just plants the seed, and God takes care of the rest. The kingdom of heaven is already in the eyes and mind of God. And while I do not in any way ever say anybody should check their brains at the door when they come into church, there are some things that are beyond our knowledge. We can speculate, and that's fine, and it's good. But we need to, in the end, admit that our speculation falls short. And this is the problem we often get ourselves into. Once we start speculating, we confuse that speculation with truth. And we believe that we have captured the essence. But as soon as we believe we have captured anything about God, we believe we've boxed God. That God is now in our control. And through, I hope we see through many of the images of the kingdom of heaven, that God is not controlled by us. But it still does matter how we view the kingdom of heaven. Our views about the hereafter affect how we behave now. So for example, let's take a look at the two extremes. If we believe that everyone gets in with no accountability, you know, it's just once you die, boom, the door gets kicked open for you, and St. Peter's saying, come on in. And Ben away is on the other side, welcoming you and ready to take you through a tour, you know, looking like she did in her Wheel of Fortune days. And the coffee is ready, thank you, yes. If we think that there is, that is the kingdom of heaven, that everybody just gets in and there is no accountability, then we here now are not likely going to look at what it means to change lives, either others or, more importantly, our own. Because it doesn't matter. The game's been set. It's just so fat. It's already done. All we got to do is eat, drink, and be merry here. Or on the other extreme, if we believe that there are only a few good people, and often when you come across these people, a few good people, of course, include them. I've never ever heard anybody say there are only the pure people are going to heaven, and I'm not one of them. You don't hear that. You hear the line drawn, me and my friends are going to heaven, I don't know about you. Well, if we believe that, then we're going to focus, of course, as you could just hear in the tone of my voice, not on helping people, not on reaching out to people, but on judging people. And I'm going to let you figure out, because I'm going to bet none of us here are at either extreme, but figure out where we are and figure out the effect that it has. Because in the end, my friends, this is all we know of heaven. And this is the one who, like the kings in his stories, like the masters in his stories, has called us to account for what we have done, for what we have been given and how we used it. But he is also the one who has called us to accept love and grace now. To what shall we compare the kingdom of heaven? And what is the kingdom of heaven? I think I can say this without equivocation. It is the moment of eternal joy in his presence. I hope that we would want that, and that we would want everybody to share that, not out of any sense of fear, not out of fear of being judged, but out of hope for the joy that is to come. Anybody have any thoughts or questions before I say amen? Pray with me.